Welcome, everybody. My name is Anthony Tamburri, and I'm Dean of the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute. I'm delighted to be able to have a conference this year. Last year, obviously, we couldn't do it due to the initial onset of the onslaught, we should say, of COVID-19, the pandemic. So we're here. We decided that we would basically do last year's conference this year. We are challenged, of course, by Zoom. We're challenged by the time, things of that sort. So we decided that we would make each session, we would organize each session on a daily basis so that no one had to do a marathon of six, seven sessions in front of a computer. We're hopeful that this is going to be work out really well. We're going to begin today. So I just want to, first of all, there are numerous people to thank. While it seems that the conference was already organized, it was to some degree, but there was a lot of work to do nonetheless to get it up into an electronic delivery format. So first and foremost, the person who was always in charge has been in charge of our conferences, Dr. Joseph Shura, who is the Director of Academic and Cultural Affairs at Cultural Programs at the Calandra Institute, and other people who have helped in an intimate way include Rosangela Briscese, Sean Gibby, Lisa Cicchetti. The wonderful visuals we see are basically Lisa Cicchetti. We're being filmed, and these videos will be up and running because of the great work of Catalina Santamaria and Eugenio Pizzorno. We wouldn't be here at all if it weren't for Carmen Pizzirusso, who is hiding behind the scenes always when we do these things, and his expertise has really facilitated a lot of things. And then finally, last but not least, is Rosaria Musco, who always makes sure that from an administrative point of view, things get done. And so here we are. We're delighted to try out this format. And this first session, I must say, is a sort of a Calandra session in a way, because in some way, shape, or form, all three speakers are related to Calandra. And that too is wonderful, a wonderful way to start out. We also need to tip a hat to our president, Frank Wu, and to, of course, our chancellor, Felix Matos Rodriguez, each of whom, not only because of the offices that they occupy, but because they too are involved, engaged intellectually in, for lack of a better term, ethnic studies, diaspora studies, and the sort. So we thank them as well. So just a few words about borders, and then we can begin. I just want to steal a little bit from myself, and I'll be very brief. So borders can come in all sorts of forms. First and foremost, they can be material boundaries, brims, outskirts that close off, if not close in, people, things, and other realia, right? Borders can be metaphorical parameters that cognitively or intellectually mark off one phenomenon from another. Whatever the case may be, borders provoke notions of distinction and discreteness, which may also, dare we say, lead on occasion to perceptions of difference and divergence, if not contrast. Borders, further still, may have their origins in the political, the economic, and/or the cultural, and as such, they're inherently invested with an ideological charge dependent on the semiosphere, we say, in certain clusters, of the individual who discerns and hence identifies said marker of separation. And so with that, let us begin our session. It is New York Borderlands. As I said, we have three presenters. Our first presenter is Professor Amy Traver, who's at Queensborough Community College, City University of New York, and it's negotiating the upstate downstate divide, Fiorello H. LaGuardia, New York State's milk crisis, and the potential for rural urban coalitions today. Prego, Amy.
Thank you so much for having me. Let me open up my slides. And are you able to see them?
Yep, we're good.
Okay, good. So let me do the slideshow. Great. Well, again, thank you for having me and for everyone's efforts in making today possible. I know on a very intimate level how much work these can be. So it's a pleasure to initiate Calandra's Dynamic Weeks of Scholarly Programming to be with all of you today. So my presentation actually reflects a diversion from my larger historical sociological research project, which examines the placement of New York City orphans on upstate dairy farms during the period 1853 to 1929. As I'm not an Italian Americanist or an expert on the Guardia, I look forward to learning from your comments on this bit of upstate and downstate history. So New York City Mayor Fiorello H. LaGuardia was practiced in the negotiation of boundaries. On a personal level, his Catholic Jewish heritage reflected his parents' union across the borders of Italy and Trieste. His fondness for Stetson cowboy hats evidenced a Western Arizona childhood that continued to inform his Eastern adult life. And his adoption of two children, a son and a daughter, challenged longstanding divisions of biological and social kinship. On a political level, LaGuardia regularly crossed foreign and domestic and federal and municipal lines as well. For instance, after stints abroad in the U.S. State Department and the Army, he rallied against isolationism from seats in Congress and city government. Likewise, as Republican mayor of New York City, he skillfully implemented progressive policies that appealed to diverse ethnic constituencies and paralleled Franklin Delano Roosevelt's Democratic presidential agenda. In this presentation, I'll focus on one example of LaGuardia's mayoral border crossings, his management of the milk crises that defined the upstate-downstate divide in New York State in the 1930s. To do so, I'll draw on manuscripts from dairy industry collections at Cornell University and LaGuardia's congressional and mayoral records at CUNY. I'll also make use of secondary materials, specifically biographies of LaGuardia written by historians and other scholars. By marshaling this evidence, I hope to highlight the foundations for and framing of Mayor LaGuardia's boundary blurring strategies and to consider his efforts as a model for rural and urban coalition building today. As a representative of New York's Greenwich Village and then East Harlem, LaGuardia served the United States Congress during the period 1917 to 1933. An anti-Tammany and Teddy Roosevelt-style Republican, he quickly emerged as a champion of new Americans and workers, becoming, in the words of biographer Ronald Bayer, a congressional bridge between the older ideology of Lincoln Republicanism and the emerging American progressive movement. Notably, this positioning is keenly reflected in LaGuardia's national level work, connecting the actions and concerns of rural Western populists who were troubled by farm profits and credit, and Eastern ethnic urbanites who were burdened by living costs and labor. One such example of LaGuardia's bridging work is his congressional opposition to the McNary-Haugen Farm Relief Bill, which sought to manage American farmers' post-World War I agricultural production and profits through government maintenance of pre-war farm prices and the sale of agricultural surpluses abroad. While the bill was supported by many members of Congress, LaGuardia challenged its framing and objectives, highlighting how the bill promised high prices for urban consumers while delivering unsustainable relief to impoverished rural farmers. LaGuardia railed against those who stood to gain from its implementation, corporate capitalists. In a May 1924 speech against the bill, LaGuardia gave voice to this dispute, and I quote, "Something is radically wrong when a condition exists that permits the manipulation of prices and the creation of monopolies on food to the extent of driving the farmer off his farm by foreclosure and having thousands of underfed and ill-nourished children in the public schools of our cities," end quote. Decrying the actions of the nation's food monopolies and trusts, he continued, denouncing the vicious, unfair, unbalanced economic system that had protected the dollar and prosperity while disregarding the producers and ignoring the human beings at the other end of the supply chain. While vetoed in its multiple iterations by President Calvin Coolidge, the McNary-Haugen Farm Relief Bill proved instructive and instrumental for LaGuardia. In later years, he spoke from the congressional floor about similar farm-based concerns, making sure when he did so to position urban and rural Americans in a commercial relationship, one mediated by the interests and exploits of corporate middlemen. For example, in 1925, he attacked the meat packers who took advantage of low-paid beef farmers and high-paying consumers. And in 1926, he derided the large baking corporations, in his words, the bread trust, that deprived wheat farmers of the profits generated by urbanites' consumption of overpriced bread. Additionally, LaGuardia spoke regularly about state interventions in the aforesaid relationship. For instance, in one 1926 congressional meeting, while describing his efforts to secure federal support for his fight against high-cost, low-profit American beef, he held up a copy of a government pamphlet on the economical use of meat, stating, "This is the help I got." By framing the government as a potential arbitrator and problem solver that had, as of yet, proven incapable of protecting rural farmers and urban consumers against corporate interests, he began quite deliberately to position himself as the beacon of his own call. LaGuardia became the 99th mayor of New York City in 1934, serving three terms until 1945. From the beginning of his mayoral career, he was presented with opportunities to test, on a more local and municipal level, his congressional policy positions. This was perhaps most true of his efforts to integrate the interests of rural producers and urban consumers, and of his call for government regulation of food monopolies. With its upstate farms and downstate customers, New York provided a bounded and intrastate testing ground for LaGuardia's work in this area, and New York State's milk market, which had long been in crisis, called out for immediate action. In 1934, New York State ranked fifth in the nation's farm income rankings, with half of that income generated through the production, processing, and sale of fluid cow's milk for New York City customers. Despite this market dominance, the state's dairy farmers struggled to stay afloat, while the city's milk consumers strained to pay the price per quart. Although the decreased demand and low agricultural pricing of the Great Depression were partially responsible for this imbalance, the state's three largest milk processors, who profited by treating farmers' raw milk and distributing that processed product for sanitary transport to city grocers, also played a part. In August of 1933, just 5 months before LaGuardia stepped into his role as New York City mayor, dairy farmers across New York State drew attention to their plight with a four-day strike, picketing processing facilities and state agricultural agencies, and dumping fluid milk along New York State roadways. Miles away, New York City residents watched in horror as the strikes grew violent, state government threatened martial law, and fluid milk dwindled in supply and increased in price. Across New York's upstate-downstate divide, the potential for disinformation and disunity was high. Thus, a newly mayored LaGuardia immediately set to work on the milk market, engaging a variety of boundary-blurring strategies to do so. First, he used every opportunity to speak directly to New York's rural farmers and the city's consumers about their co-constructed circumstances, noting at each opportunity how their relationship was mediated by the corporate interests of the state's three largest milk processors. To best communicate with consumers, Mayor LaGuardia gave voice to food costs, particularly the cost of milk, during his regular radio addresses. When doing so, he always made reference to the economic underpinnings of these costs, noting price increases related to seasonal and labor-based shortages, as well as issues of corporate dominance and greed. To best communicate with farmers, Mayor LaGuardia actually went where farmers were, frequently accepting invitations to speak beyond his jurisdiction at upstate gatherings and National Farm Bureau events. Shortly after taking office at one such event, the mayor began his comments by acknowledging the ways in which city consumers, whom we call workers, and rural producers were bound together in mutual interest and exploitation. And I quote, "The problem of the farmer and the problem of the urban worker are tied up directly together. The dweller in rural areas supplies the goods and services needed by the dweller in urban areas. Yet there are groups in this nation who would seek to accentuate seemingly superficial differences of interest between farmers and workers. I say here and now that they do so in order to simulate strife and mutual distress among those whose interest is a common one. They are willing to go to unusual lengths to prevent loss of their dominance, even though it means the kindling of the fire of unrest based upon false differences between farmer and worker," unquote. Markedly, in laying the consumer-producer relationship bare, Mayor LaGuardia did more than integrate the interests of downstate and upstate New Yorkers. He also connected the specifics of New York's milk crisis to larger and perhaps more temporally salient issues of industrial inequality and economic division. Mayor LaGuardia's second boundary blurring strategy involved outspoken attacks on the state's three largest milk processors. At times, the mayor confronted processors as a representative of city consumers. For example, in one 1930 protest against processors' increased price per quart, Mayor LaGuardia stated, and I quote, "This increase is not justified. This sort of thing has been going on for far too long. I want to be cooperative with all connected with the production and distribution of milk, but I can't stand idly by and see the consumers getting the raw end of it every time," end quote. At other times, however, the mayor intervened as a representative of the state's dairy farmers. In a 1937 telegram to the chairman of the state's largest milk processing corporation, he criticized a consumer price increase that offered little to rural producers in return. Declaring himself a better farm ally than was the corporation's leadership, he stated, and I quote, "For years, I've been aiding the farmer to get a just and equitable return for his products. You use the same phraseology and wording of the middleman. You don't talk like farmers, and the giveaway is easy. I'm ready to get together with the farmers anytime," end quote. As you might imagine, in representing consumers and producers, Mayor LaGuardia won the trust and furthered the integration of both parties. This is evidenced in letters of support sent to the mayor from New Yorkers across the state. For instance, in one 1937 communication, a representative of New York City's Consumer Protection Committee wrote, and I quote, "We are well aware of the fact that the dairy farmers need more money for their milk. Their welfare is inescapably tied up with ours. Thanks to monopoly control, the consumer is gouged at one end and the impoverished dairy farmers gouged at the other," end quote. Pointedly, a letter from an upstate dairy farmer's wife revealed a similar sentiment. And I quote, "The intelligent farmer knows that in order to bring about a new day in the milk industry, the producer and the consumer must work hand in hand. We know that the spread between what the consumer pays and what the producer gets is entirely too much," end quote. Taken together, these letters revealed a shared confidence in Mayor LaGuardia, as well as the success of his relational messaging. In a third and final boundary blurring strategy, Mayor LaGuardia sought to bypass milk processors and to put New York City's consumers in a government-mediated relationship with the state's dairy farmers. For example, in 1934, when the state's three largest milk processors announced their plans to increase the price of milk by a penny a quart, the mayor negotiated with independent dairy farmers to supply reduced-price milk to urban health stations across the city. Later memos from Mayor LaGuardia evidence his desire to further institutionalize this relationship, revealing his efforts to set up a machinery for the pasteurization and distribution of independent farmers' milk directly by the city of New York. Likewise, later in the decade, when the state's largest milk processors threatened another price increase, Mayor LaGuardia convened with city health officials to promote city residents' consumption of grade B milk, a lower-priced alternative to the processor's preferred grade A variety. In one radio speech on the topic, the mayor described grade B milk as equal in nutrition and taste to the higher standard alternative, and he urged city consumers to look past the deceptive advertising of milk processors to the relational benefits of grade B consumption. And I quote, "They're attempting with reckless misinterpretation, distortion of figures and facts, even juggling with bacteria and chemistry, to plug the more expensive milk. There's little difference in the quality of the milk. The best proof that this highly advertised milk is profitable is the desperate attempts that they've made by these companies in the reckless pursuit of advertising," end quote. Referring to the state's milk processors as barons and chiselers, Mayor LaGuardia defined city government as a trust-busting provider of public utilities and reliable information. In doing so, he positioned government as the most appropriate mediator of the state's interdependencies. So, consistent with the aims of historical sociology, I see LaGuardia's congressional and mayoral efforts as of a piece with New York's contemporary urban-rural divide and as a template for its effacement. Thus, I'd like to conclude my comments by making a theoretical and transferable sense of the boundary blurring strategies that Mayor LaGuardia employed during New York State's mill crises. In the golden age of radio, Mayor LaGuardia understood the power of communication. Not only did he connect with the public through direct expressions of shared suffering, dignity, and hope, he also used his voice to put the public in relationship. This is perhaps most evident in his efforts to connect the state's urban and rural people, who at times of economic crisis and social change were equal parts dependent on and mistrustful of each other. Rejecting the purity claims that divided cities from farmlands, Mayor LaGuardia embraced the new consumerist movement and defined the terms of urban and rural New Yorkers' integration accordingly, production and consumption. To solidify this discursive and material relationship, he used the language of antitrust activists to highlight the central role corporate middlemen, like the state's three largest milk processors, played in residents' linked and place-based experiences of economic exploitation. Bound together through need and shared marginalization, and defined against a corporate outgroup, urban and rural New Yorkers came to see themselves as parallel participants in a wider economic and social system that just operated in locally specific and differentiated ways. A fierce patriot and an avowed anti-socialist, Mayor LaGuardia defended the state's small capitalists, who sought not to get rich at the expense of their fellow New Yorkers, but to achieve the economic stability and opportunity necessary to provide for their families. Yet he also stood for inclusive government, a democracy, as a means to expand the free but fair and equitable agricultural and industrial economies in which such stability and opportunity was achieved. Thus, in matters of public concern, like the consumption and production of fluid milk, Mayor LaGuardia attempted to dismantle the concentrated corporate power and shift the structural control of markets to government, making civic agencies not divisive middlemen or unfettered market forces, the interlocutor of New Yorkers' newly defined relationship. Truthfully, this analysis leaves me wondering about our ability to tackle, on a state-based level, many of the crises that define and divide urban and rural Americans today. With deference to the fact that LaGuardia's efforts unfolded in a particular historical, social, and political context, what urban and rural boundary blurring strategies remain when we consume products that are largely produced elsewhere? On what foundation might our relationships reside when corporations control the government and media institutions that once framed them as outgroups? What happens when political power stems not from the unity of a populace, but from its division? With both LaGuardia and today's struggles in mind, I conclude. Thank you.
Thank you. We are entertaining questions, and we already have one. So let me read them to you, Amy. The first question, and it's from our colleague, Sean Gibby. So LaGuardia didn't see what he was doing as bridging boundaries per se. He was actually pointing up what he called false differences, correct?
That's not a framing I'm familiar with, but it runs consistent with my reading and the evidence that I've seen, absolutely. I think that his emphasis on the relationships with people and their sort of shared marginalization really highlights that.
Okay. We have another one from Dominique Ryle, I suspect. I was wondering if you could discuss how your work fits with Kara Murphy Schlichting's New York Recentered. Does your analysis agree with hers, or does looking milk instead of sure change it?
This is a recommendation for me, this particular author. It's not a work with which I'm familiar. So if you could offer that recommendation again of the author, I would be very happy.
Okay. So you don't, okay. Kara Murphy, and I'll spell this for you.
Sure.
S-C-H-L-I-C-H-T-I-N-G-S. And she just sent me a link.
Okay, so
I'll
great.
That link. I'll try to send that link to you. Okay.
So I'll just mention this, as I stated in the introduction, this is a bit of a diversion from my original research project, which looks at the placement of New York City orphans, many of whom were Italian American kids that were placed on upstate New York dairy farms. And the thing that I find in that analysis is the way in which in solving a social welfare problem in placing these children on upstate farms, we also see a bit of an overlap in the way that we're talking about milk at the time. This was a public utility. There was great concern about the health of the milk that was being sent from upstate farms to New York City. There were connections between some health issues that children were experiencing in New York City and the quality of the milk. So I find it really interesting that children were being sent to work on these upstate farms, and then the product that they were helping to generate was being sent back to New York City to feed the children left behind in the institutions that they left behind. And so this was actually just an interesting kind of avenue off of this larger project, which hinted at a lot of the same kind of energies, the upstate, downstate divide, the purity versus impure kinds of claims that were being made about children's experiences in the city versus on country farms, milk made in the city. You know, we had these swill milk kind of markets versus milk generated upstate. So it really got at some of the same kind of juxtapositions. Okay. But I'm learning. This is a new avenue for me.
There's actually two follow-ups, and then we'll move on to our next speaker. But she says, this is Donna Gabacha. And she says, did LaGuardia imagine upstater farmers as, quote, American-American, end of quote, natives and New York consumers as recent immigrants? You sort of seem to touch on that a little bit, but yeah.
I get the impression from my experience that he saw them all as New Yorkers and Americans. He has become a little bit of a personal beacon for me. I mean, how do we integrate difference in a union that honors difference? I think that he did that beautifully. And I think he would, I hope, or at least my interpretation was that he would say they were both Americans in different ways, right? It's kind of like the economic argument that I think is made through his work. It's that it's shared exploitation in different ways, right? So it's shared Americanness in different ways.
Good. Okay. Thank you. There was one more comment from Dominique, but let me ask Dominique to maybe email you and see.
Because that'd be helpful.
I'll send you the link that she sent in the chat in case you.
This is what I was hoping for. Thank you.
Good. Okay. Thank you, Amy. Our second speaker is a member of the Calandra Institute staff, Stephen CERULLI, depending on where you're coming from. And he is one of our college assistants. He works for us, helping us with our research. He's also an adjunct instructor at Hostos Community College. The title of his talk is Wyckoff Heights, Italian-American Borderland on the Brooklyn-Queens Line. Prego, Stephen.
So the name of my presentation is Wyckoff Heights, Italian-American Borderland on the Brooklyn-Queens Line. Spacebar, what's the best way to move this forward? There we go. All right, so here's the really brief table of contents. I'll just use this time to talk about how I kind of stumbled onto this project. A couple years ago, I moved into Wyckoff Heights, and I was seeing all this kind of visible Italianita, as you can see from this 9/11 mural here on Seneca Avenue. With Italian and American flags. So I started documenting it on my own. And then maybe about a year and a half ago, the Calandra announced this conference. And I was like, oh, this is a good opportunity to put all this photos and sources that I was looking into for a project to kind of synthesize and summarize everything that I was looking at. So let's talk about, I need to look at my big computer to match this. So what is Wyckoff Heights? Well, Wyckoff Heights, essentially today, is kind of a shared neighborhood between Ridgewood, Queens, and Bushwick, Brooklyn. And it has its origins in the development of the area in the 1890s. So this is a wonderful map from 1912, from a book called The Eastern District of Brooklyn. If anyone is doing anything in North Brooklyn, this is definitely a source you should look at. Contemporary Bushwick was already developed by the 1890s, it was a predominantly German neighborhood, famous for breweries. Apparently 15% of the beer brewed in America was produced in Bushwick. So Bushwick's already established. However, beginning in the 1890s, the area north of Central Avenue, which is Hamburg Avenue here, began to develop. And it was called Ridgewood, Brooklyn, which sounds really weird to say because we think Ridgewood, you think Ridgewood, Queens. But it was called Ridgewood, Brooklyn. And part of the area north of it, right here, was called Wyckoff Heights. This is an area that's developing in the late 1890s. The name Wyckoff Heights comes from the Wyckoff family, which was an old Knickerbocker, and that's like Dutch settler family. And the part Heights comes from the fact that it sits on a plateau. So if you go on Wyckoff Street right here and stand in the middle of the street, you can see the skyline of Manhattan because it sits up on a plateau. By the 1920s, this area is primarily German, but as we'll see, that kind of changes a little bit on. Here's two clippets from the Brooklyn Daily Eagle. This one dates to 1892 and talks about Wyckoff Heights as part of Queens. And this one is from 1900, which talks about Wyckoff Heights as part of Brooklyn and being attached to the Brooklyn Post Office. At this point in time, the post office was all the way up in Flushing. So that gives you a kind of ideal of the shifting borders of this neighborhood from its development. Here is a, this is taken from a New York Times article from 1951. In the area, we see its own post office, the Wyckoff Heights Post, Wyckoff Heights Station in 1951. And this kind of further also helps it cement its link with Brooklyn, despite the fact that in 1925, the official borders of Brooklyn and Queens as the counties and boroughs are decided. There's still lots of confusion about what side this area sits on. And we'll see later in this presentation of how Italian Americans kind of help set the permanent defining border of this area. So here's a map that I made horribly. Ooh. I'm sorry, I'm just looking at my main computer. Here's a map that I horribly made on Paint. I just want to go back to real second. Those are clippings I mentioned. So here's a map I horribly made on Microsoft Paint, giving a rough estimate of what the area looks like in today's borders. So the pink here is Bushwick, Brooklyn. The blue here is Ridgewood, Queens. So which group settled here? Well, primarily there's two kind of areas I can pinpoint them to, which interestingly enough are also borders. You're seeing all the connection, border states in Italy, seeing all the connections with the conference themes. Most of the people, the Italians that settled here were from Sicily, especially Castellammare del Golfo, Santa Maria de Valice, Acamo, Castrano, and Santa Nifa. However, there's also another notable group from the Val di Non in Trentino. So how is this area formed into like an Italian neighborhood? Well, there's essentially two waves. I'm going to quickly go through both of them because they both have different defining features. So the first wave takes place between 1910 and 1950. The first kind of documentation of Sicilians in Bushwick, which you remember Wyckoff Heights, most of it sits in Bushwick, is the founding of Il Circolo Santa Maria da Belice in 1911. Now they still exist today. However, they now exist in Glendale, Queens, and this also very much fits a trend that we'll talk about later. Where do most of these Sicilians come from? You know, many Sicilians have already settled in New York City during this time period throughout the first decades of the 1900s because of changing tenement laws, amongst many other things. There's a lot of shuffling in between neighborhoods. So these Sicilians originate from the ones settling in Wyckoff Heights from around Our Lady Pompeii Church in East Williamsburg. However, in 1919, they lay out the foundations for St. Joseph's parishes within walking distance of this area, such as St. Barbara's, which was German-Irish, St. Aloysius, which is German, St. Leonard's, which is German, St. Bridget's, which is German-Irish, right? It is all walking distance from Wyckoff Heights, but the Italians did not attend mass at these churches, which were probably German-Irish, so they found their own church, which is St. Joseph. Another reason for coming to this area is this is a continuous stretch of factory employment, stretching from Williamsburg all the way to East New York. As I mentioned earlier, on Bushwick Avenue, there's tons of breweries. Flushing Avenue in particular is a major center, and Flushing Avenue runs right across the edge of Wyckoff Heights. So it's very much within the borders. Also, there's easy access to the Brooklyn Navy Yard through the elevated M line and the trams running down Flushing Avenue. Going off tax records from the 40s, I couldn't find any Italian businesses north of Cypress Avenue, which is contemporarily the Ridgewood, Queens, Brooklyn border. In the 1920s, Knickerbocker Avenue becomes a major kind of Italian commercial center. as one person described it to me, it was a little Italy. And by 1950, we have this large swath of Italian Americans going all the way from the north end of Williamsburg to East New York. That doesn't mean it's exclusively Italian Americans living in these areas, but there's a huge continuous kind of swath of them from East Williamsburg all the way to East New York. Another important thing to note is how were these Sicilians able to afford to live in this area? Well, around the same time in the 19-teens, when there's a mass exodus of Germans leaving Bushwick to live in nicer housing in a somewhat nicer, wider area out in Ridgewood, Queens. So these two neighborhoods are very much connected with each other, Bushwick, Brooklyn, and Ridgewood, Queens. And we can see already here by the 1920s, we see Germans leaving Bushwick heading to Ridgewood, Queens. Here's just a note from St. Joseph's. We can see the Italian American community is well established here. There's a famous feast of St. Joseph's. In 1949, these towers are dedicated to the patron saint. St. Joseph was also a very predominantly heavy Sicilian saint. As I mentioned, these two neighborhoods are extremely connected. What's the appeal of Ridgewood, Queens? One of the things to notice, I like including as much photos that I think as possible. Well, there's these things called the Matthew Model Flats, which are essentially these very, state-of-the-art style tenements compared to the tenements that the Sicilians are coming into in Bushwick, which are built in the 1880s, 1890s, very cramped, vinyl siding. We have here in Ridgewood, these beautiful brick, yellow brick from Staten Island, basically almost row-style tenements designed particularly for the German working class, right? And these German working class folks can take the trams or take the subway to the brewery or whatever industry they're working for in Bushwick. It's only like a 10-minute ride. So that, this creates the conditions to allow for a mass of new Sicilian Italian immigrants to come into this area. So then there's wave two. As I mentioned, there's two waves. One thing to note is already by this time period in the 1960s, I have a big 30-year period, many of the Italians that are living in Bushwick, let's say circa 1940, 1930, by the 1970s, 1980s, are already going into the surrounding neighborhoods of Queens, which are Ridgewood, Maspeth, and Glendale. A thing of note is in the 1960s, after the lifting of the 1924 Immigrant Quota Acts to an extent, a new wave of Sicilians come into Bushwick and Wyckoff Heights and re-Italianize the area. They're famously known as Zips, according to the journalist Kevin B. Sullivan. It's because of their flashy dress and lightning quick Sicilian prose. And this essentially leads to a re-Italianization of the area. And I would make the argument, this is why we see lots of Italians, or at least Italian presence, in North Bushwick / Wyckoff Heights compared to neighborhoods like the north part of Bed-Stuy or East New York, which were also heavily Italian, but have no kind of visible Italianita the way Northern Bushwick does, because there is a re-Italianization of the area. Of note, also, by the 1960s, there is a small but vibrant group of Trentini, which are from Northern Italy, centered around Cypress and Gates Avenue, which is in Wyckoff Heights. It's the very eastern corners of it. And one was telling me, it was funny, that half of them lived in Brooklyn and then half of them lived in Queens. Some other major events is in the 1960s, this area, Wyckoff Heights, becomes the center of the Banana War, which is the Bonanno power struggle in the mafia. And by the end of this period, in the mid-70s, we see the rise of this guy named Carmine Galante, who is essentially the de facto leader of the Bonanno family. And he has a base of operations out of Knickerbocker Avenue, right? And he's also famous for calling over many other Sicilian immigrants into the area. And it basically leads to Knickerbocker being like a very strong mafia center, best way to put it. He's actually killed in July 12th, 1979, a major event in American mafia history. He famously introduces heroin into the neighborhood, which is taken over by local gangs following his death. And that leads to Knickerbocker Avenue, which was once like the Little Italy, becoming this really blighted, drug infested area. And all this is responding to national and systemic changes, the war on drugs, white flight, et cetera, et cetera. This is just kind of the local Italian American response to these. There's a great quote by one of my old neighbors and I asked about Galante's death. And he goes, another place has never opened there, the restaurant where he was shot. So I went down there to see if that was true. And lo and behold, you know, heavily gentrified modern Bushwick. There's nothing in the storefront that was there. Another major Italian American in this time period is a guy named Vito Lopez. He's Sicilian American with a Spanish grandfather. He's born in Bensonhurst, but in the early 1970s, he arrives to Bushwick, Wyckoff Heights, and he becomes a major local figure. I'll talk a little bit more about him on a slide or two, but he's one of these major Italian figures that shapes the neighborhood. We also see in the 1970s, as more Sicilians are coming in, a lot of southern Bushwick is being burnt to the ground. And this is a very common phenomenon in New York in the 1970s, where landlords would pay an arsonist to burn the money down to collect the insurance money. So I asked an older, he's 71, Italian American guy, said, do you know anyone who burnt their buildings down? And he goes, yeah, a few friends do that. And the reason why is because they couldn't collect money from getting rent, right? So again, this is all part of larger trends that we see nationwide and how Italian Americans locally are responding to this. And another common thing, part of these larger white flight trends is blockbusting, where real estate agents would go to your house and say, African-Americans or Latinos are going to move to your neighborhood. That's going to depreciate your home values. So sell it to me now before you can't sell it. And there's a great kind of antidote to this in the book of memoir, Con Amore by Beatrice Yanni, who talks about how basically her family, her Sicilian family in Bushwick is terrified of the kind of the prospect of losing all their savings in their house. So they sell their property and move up to Ridgewood, right? And as, like, I can't emphasize enough that these two neighborhoods on the Brooklyn-Queens border are in dialogue with each other, constantly reflecting each other and shaping each other throughout the 20th century. Something to consider is that in 1960, Bushwick, which is where most of Wyckoff Heights is based out of, is 90% white. By 1990, it's 10% white. Ridgewood, however, on the hand, remains a white majority neighborhood in 2010. This is going off 2010 census numbers. Just really briefly to show you, you know, the kind of influence the mafia did have in the neighborhood. This is from a pretty well-known map of mafia social clubs. We see a large concentration of them in the Wyckoff Heights area. And here is that Bonanno event I was talking about, the massacre, right? Several events also took place in American mafia history. Here's photos of Wyckoff Heights in the early 1960s. And then this is a really fantastic postcard I found online from eBay of the Feast of St. Joseph on Sydenham and Knickerbocker in 1967. However, we see by the 80s, the neighborhood has a very different look using New York City tax records, right? Here's an example of burnt down buildings, which again, Bushwick had a ton of. At the same time though, there's a coffee shop still on the old in the old neighborhood on Knickerbocker Avenue. And there's like dozens of these. I was looking through the records and there'd be like three coffee shops within two blocks from each other. And by coffee shops, like Italian style cafes. So another person that I want to briefly touch upon is Vito Lopez, as I mentioned, Italian American, right? Interesting, he gets a degree in like community organizing from Yeshiva University, moves into Bushwick in the early 1970s. And he famously founds the Ridgewood Bushwick Senior Citizens Council. And essentially, this is a coalition with Italian Americans, Latino Americans, and African Americans that want to preserve their homes in Bushwick and Ridgewood, right? As other homes are burning, right? And as there's urban blight, the whole point of this council is to maintain their homes in this neighborhood, right? And there's lots of single family homes, especially towards the border. As Lopez goes on, the group grows and they start doing things like buying old homes and renovating them and providing affordable housing. However, by the time we hit the 2010s, he begins to advocate an expansion of the loft laws. And as I mentioned earlier, around Flushing Avenue, there's tons of industry, right? And what the expansion of the loft laws, which begin in lower Manhattan out of places like Soho and Tribeca, right, allow former warehouses and factories to become renovated as residential units, i.e. lofts, right? And he becomes a major advocate of changing the laws to allow the lofts in Wyckoff Heights and in Bushwick and in Ridgewood to be renovated and become housing. So the next thing we're gonna do here is look at some tracts, right? And the tracts we're looking at, these are census tracts for those who don't know. We're gonna be looking at these northern tracts in Bushwick. So this is Brooklyn. and these southern tracts in Ridgewood, just to get an idea of the demographic trends of Italian Americans. So as many people know, in the 1980s, the first year that people, Italian Americans, can identify as Italian Americans on the census. And what you see is there's still a heavy portion of Italian Americans in northern Bushwick. They're about a quarter of the neighborhood, generally speaking, in the Wyckoff Heights area, which is northern Bushwick. And as you see in Queens and Ridgewood, they're even much higher, 40% in some tracts, 30%, around 30% in the other, right? And you can literally see the population moving up out of Bushwick into Ridgewood. As we enter the 90s, it's even, I have two screens going at once. We see the decrease of Italian Americans in Bushwick now, only around 11%. Those are around Wyckoff Avenue, which was once like Knickerbocker Avenue, a major kind of commercial hub, with Ridgewood still having a decent amount. In the 1990s census, if you look at northern Ridgewood, it's like 50-60% Italian in some of the tracks, especially around this place called Freshwater Pond Road. So what's Wyckoff Heights then, right? We keep talking about this, you know, how does it come into our kind of modern, our modern sense of the neighborhood? Well, in 1979, there is a distinct splitting of the zip codes of Ridgewood and Glendale, which is another neighborhood next to Bushwick and Ridgewood, from Bushwick, right? And the person who leads the kind of charge for that is Geraldine Ferraro, who's recently elected. Who's recently elected. And she's essentially the person to lead that, you know, gets the split. And what this does is leave a heavy Italianized portion of the population on the Brooklyn border of the new zip codes. Now Ridgewood and Glendale have 11385 zip codes, right? This leads to the catalyzation of Wyckoff Heights. I'm gonna skip ahead. As we see this sign from Cypress Avenue, which is literally the Brooklyn-Queens border, we see Welcome to Wyckoff Heights, sponsored by the Wyckoff Heights Neighborhood Association and Chase Bank. Essentially, we have Italian Americans here trying to maintain their property values as the rest of the neighborhood depreciates throughout the 80s and 90s. Here's some example of housing from that period that still exists today, brick and mortar, you know, lots of side streets full of these. Here's a glimpse from the 80s and 90s, a New York Times article talking about how this area is still heavily Italian American. I'm not gonna go through everything since we are short on time, but as I note here, there's still plenty of Italian American establishments in the area. And in the 1994 study, according to our Institute's Vincenzo Milone, Ridgewood was the most Italian-born neighborhood in all of Queens. So that gives you an idea of the Sicilian immigrants leaving Bushwick and going up into Ridgewood. As I mentioned, Knickerbocker and Wyckoff become decentered, and these other streets, Fresh Pond Road, Metropolitan Avenue, Myrtle Avenue, and Grand Avenue in Queens become the new kind of center of Italian-American businesses. So I'm going to skip ahead and go to today's numbers. As you see, only around 5%, 4% of Italian Americans living in that area. And I want to note that now it's heavily gentrifying and Italian Americans are part of that process as well. Here's Joseph Ficola. He establishes the Bushwick Collective, which essentially turns this northern part of Bushwick into an artist haven and Mecca. Here's some photos of the neighborhood presently. I just want to get to my conclusions. And essentially, I think I should rethink the naming of this project from to reclaiming Wyckoff Heights or reshaping Wyckoff Heights, since Italian Americans are very much defined this area. There we go.
Thank you. Sorry.
I had more, like a 40 minute slide.
Okay. That's all right. That's okay. Because we have four questions. So, you know, that'll be good. Yeah. So, okay. So the first question is, let me see if I can maybe go through a couple of these.
I see them.
Okay. Yeah.
The first question is Lady Pompey still an active parish? Yes. Latinos, Puerto Ricans, it's still there. And so is St. Joseph, which is also predominantly Ecuadorian and Mexican. I see also, was there a large paper and lace factory employed Italian Americans in this part of Brooklyn? It's primarily breweries in the early years, and then later on, general kind of industry. So I wouldn't be surprised if there's a paper and lace. Ridgewood, part of Flushing Avenue, was famous for its knitting mills. A significant portion of knitted shirts came from this area. But it was all types of factories around that area. So next question is, what was Ferraro's impetus for getting the zip code changed? What did she or her constituents want? So the people living in Ridgewood and in Glendale wanted to detach their zip code from Bushwick. Because as I noted, like something like 20% of Bushwick's housing stock was burnt down to the ground in 3 years. On top of the fact, there's this major riot. It's called the 1977 blackouts, which leads to a bunch of looting in southern Bushwick. So essentially you have the Italian-American homeowners living in Ridgewood and Glendale who own property now, leading for this push to change the neighborhood zip code. And this is kind of the permanent splitting off of Ridgewood, Queens from Bushwick, Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. Yes, I can send you the presentation if you want. I don't mind if you shoot me your email address.
Email address. So where are we? So you were concluding, and I think, were you getting to numbers? Where are we now? I think you were getting to the numbers when I cut you off.
I am there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Around 4 or 5% in some of the tracks, not much compared to the 20-30% we saw in the '80s. Mm-hmm. And, I just want to finish off with one really cool picture that I found online that I think captures the kind of modern Italian-American in Wyckoff Heights, where this is from a page I found on Facebook. Uh-huh. It's called the Brooklyn Sicilian Bushwick, right? Uh-huh. The name of the page. And here we see Wyckoff Avenue, right? As I mentioned, a major thoroughway with Italian-American food, specifically Sicilian, and then behind it, modern art, because the neighborhood has become gentrified and become this kind of art haven.
Okay. All right. Good. Good. So, okay, so we have another minute or two for the question period. Peter Barbella, by the way, sent you his email, which you can see in the Q&A, right?
I got it. Thank you so much. I copied it.
All right. Okay. Okay. So then if there are no more questions or comments, we can move on to our third speaker. Our third speaker is Rosemary Serra, the University of Trieste, who also has a connection to the Calandra Institute, is being one of our fellows and having visited and done research on other occasions, and we're happy to have her. The title of her talk is The Young Italians' Visions and Dreams of New York, Myth or Reality?
The purpose of my talk is to examine how the myth of New York influenced the imagination of people today. It's in fact known that the United States is a primary destination for a high number of young Italians in search of job and study opportunities. While the push factors are predictable and recurring as they are linked to internal problems in the Italian economy, pull factors are more complex and refer to the repertoire of unconscious mental images that individuals build in the long run through the process of socialization or their life experience. These mental images are influenced by the individual characteristics and the social and the cultural environment in which the subject are inserted, and that gives shape to their imagery of migration. In particular, the myth of destination country refers to the positive narrative about the political, social, and cultural condition that characterize that country, and that operates a kind of anticipatory socialization of potential migrants. In the case of the United States, the American dream still seems to have a powerful attractive force, just as the myth of New York City still appears very powerful in the imagination of Italians. A recent survey of a sample of about 4,000 Italians and 3,000 Argentines, to which I collaborated, found that the city of New York is a symbolic place for a very large number of subjects, mainly young people, who consider it a place where they would love to live. The attractive power that New York exerts will be examined through the study of the profile of the people who choose it as an ideal place and the reason that inspire this choice. The data that I analyze here are the result of a study that took place in Italy and Argentina starting from 2015. The research was entitled Identity and Nature and looked at two general topics: identity, understood perhaps more broadly than usual, and the relationship of the individual with nature, animals, plants, natural phenomena. The data collection in Italy ended in the summer of 2017 with over 3,900 questionnaires collected. In Argentina, the data gathering was much slower and ended in December 2019 with almost 2,600 questionnaires. The respondents are included in the following age groups. So table one, you can see the distribution, the age group of the Italian sample and the Argentinian sample. The age group are balanced, except for the Italian 60 and over 60 years old plus, which is more numerous. The questionnaire included the following question. Now we propose that you choose between six symbolic plays on art. Tell us one of them in which you would like to live and one in which you would never want to live. The alternative to choose were Las Vegas, New York, Kathmandu, Venice, a South Sea island, and a quiet provincial town. Then the reason for the choice and refusal were asked. Next, this question followed. Now, consider the other four places. Would you place them in order of preference from the second favorite place to the fifth? In the table two, the places are presented in the same order in which they followed each other on the questionnaire. In the two agents absence columns, so you can see the number of time they have been chosen at the favorite place and the number of time they have been chosen at the sixth, i.e. last. So this is the table two. As can be seen, the first place in the ranking is assigned to the provincial town, followed by New York, while at the bottom of the list we find Las Vegas and Kathmandu. Now let's go on the table three. So the frequency distribution of the score relating to the preference of New York as an ideal place highlights that almost 40% of the Italian respondents and over 38% of the Argentine respondents rank the city first or second in the list of the symbolic places. Among the sociographic characteristics of the interviews, age is the one that exerts the greatest influence on the choice of the city. So now is figure one. Figure one shows how in the Italian sample left in the figure, the younger an interviewee is, the more he or she likes New York, represented by a lower box. This age effect is very marked in the younger age group of the sample, where the average of the scores stands on the choice of New York in second position. The tendency to like the city decreases with higher age. In Argentina, too, the youngest people give the metropolis the highest position, while for the elderly, the average of the approval score is in the fifth place. Now, table four. Table four shows that women from both countries tend to give first place in the ranking to New York more than men. In the table five, I present the relationship between the educational qualification and the choice first or second of New York, both for Italians and Argentines. The most frequent preference of the city by those with the highest qualification stand out, while these options fall by those with a technical or a low level of the education. Now let's go. Analyzing the marital status of the Italian sample, it is noted that the separated, the divorced, and the widowers show a low propensity to choose New York. They tend to be older than the rest of the population. Therefore, the relationship is influenced by age. In part, this is also true for married couples. Their low propensity to choose New York can also be explained by their eradication in the territory due to the presence of children. The same trend can be observed in the Argentine sample, in which, above all, single people prefer New York. The type of occupation does not show any relationship with the position attributed to New York in the choice. The only exception is the attraction between student status and the high tendency to give New York as the first choice. Now let's see table 8. The interviews who choose New York as the first place, the first ideal place, express an inclination to consider the possibility of moving elsewhere, above all for family and emotional needs, but also for occupational needs, decline at various levels, a search for a better salary, more gratification, or just for a job they don't have. A higher salary seems to count more than the other two reasons. And for the Italians in particular, the search for employment opportunities appear much more marked as a reason for leaving the motherland that is for Argentines. There is also a fairly pronounced disposition to move, motivated by the desire to change. The search for better social contact and more intense cultural life could also affect those who prefer New York and who would be willing to leave their own land. Respondents who have chosen New York as the ideal place have indicated it above all for the opportunity to find better paid or more rewarding job. There was also open question to go deeper and to understand why people choose or reject New York. The answer to the open question dedicated to clarify which each interview choose or discard one of the six places highlights some salient aspect of New York in the collective imagination. We have no time to go deeper in this, but if you look at the table 9 and 10, you can see the reason that led Italians and Argentines to indicate New York as their favorite city to live in. So you can see in the first table, the table 9, you see the main reason that led Italians to choose New York. And in the other, table 10 shows the main reason that led Argentines to choose New York as the ideal place. On the other hand, we have two other tables that summarize the reason that prompted the Italian to discard New York. This is table 11 and table 12 that I put together. For Argentines, the most often mentioned reason for refusal are the consequence of the size as well as the chaotic and stressful nature of the city. This is the last part is interesting, the connection that put together the propensity to choose New York as a favorite place with a self-centered identity. In both the Italian and the Argentine sample, and we have to look at the table 13, those who prefer New York show a very strong focus on the self. The most plausible hypothesis that binds this connection is determined by the fact that those with a strong ego tend to choose New York because they are confident in their chances of being successful. This hypothesis is confirmed by the choice of qualities that distinguish those who prefer New York. In the questionnaire, there was a list of faculties attributable to plants, animals, and natural phenomena. We can look at the table 14, which had the two purpose of identify some personality traits of an individual interviewed. Respondents could give the faculty preference a score between 0 and 10. Table 14 presents all the faculties that have been subjected to the assessment of the interviewers, but in the ascending order of satisfaction detected by the average score attributed by the Italian respondents. This is table 14. The ranking shows that Italian value more the possibility of acquiring physical qualities than they do not have, flying, seen in the dark, or of strengthening those they already have, running, swimming. The aggressive qualities of the ray, the avalanche, the viper, the python occupy the last place, which is the with the exception of the lightning. The defensive qualities, turtle, cactus, ivy, mole, with the exception of the chameleon, are little more appreciated. We don't have time, but the table 15 shows, compare the preference of Italians and Argentines in terms of faculties to steal from animal and plants. And let's see now the last table, 13. The table 13 highlights how the interviews of the two samples who prefer New York seems to appreciate the following faculties. First, being able to run at the speed of a jaguar or a greyhound. Second, being able to incinerate obstacles like a lightning. Third, being as burning as fire. On the other hand, below the average score achieved by those who choose New York from the third position onwards, there are, first, being able to get confused in the group like an ant, being quiet as a sloth. The result can be interpreted on the basis of some grouping of the faculties that have been created to highlight the different propensity that unite them. The preference for jaguar falls into the group defined by the desire for control and freedom in space. The choice of being able to incinerate obstacles like lightning falls within the group of faculties defined by a propensity for aggression. The choice to be as burning as fire brings with it the image of a disruptive force that burns the obstacle in front of it. Those who choose New York as the ideal place show confidence in their own possibilities and in their ability to overcome obstacles, a combative self and ready to seize opportunities for achievement and success. The tranquility evoked by the sloth and the restraint of the ant willing to give up their individuality are qualities on which the average score of those who choose New York is lower than that of other interviews. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, we can. Yes.
Oh, okay, because I see blank in front of me.
Table 13 is still up on the screen.
Okay, you can take it off. And now I'm going to the conclusion. Numerous elements that emerge from the analysis of this data converge to make us reflect on the current Italian situation and lead to consider a phenomenon that characterizes many young people. This is an ongoing trend in Italy that goes under the label of new migration and that sees as a large number of young people living in Italy for work or study reasons. All kinds of immigrants are part of these flows, not only brain, but also arms, as has been said. Among the destinations of these expatriates, the United States is at the top, as it is the city of New York specifically. As emerged from some interviews I conducted on a sample of young Italians who emigrate to New York, those who move to the city are often very determined people who do not give up easily in the face of difficulties, motivated people who are not afraid to stay alone and who have moved to the city to test themselves and to find life and job opportunities. The city offers many opportunities to meet, to make new acquaintance, to forge many friendships. But faced with these opportunities, there are often times of difficulties in which it's necessary to appeal to a solid self when one is prey to sadness and loneliness. This consideration is supported by the word of a young Italian girl I interviewed. There are days when you are happy and other when you feel sad and lonely. It's a city where you have to get really strong. In the summer, especially in August, I miss Italy. In a situation like this that I am experiencing, you become a gypsy. You never root yourself. And if you are a person like me, you become emotionally unstable. Returning to the research result, those who choose the city of New York have a common characteristic to those of many young Italians who move to the city. Although the data are not adequate to establish a direct link between the choice of New York as the favorite place and a hypothetical subsequent move to the city by those who prefer it, the commonality of characteristics between the young people in December and those immigrants in the city arouses assumption. One could in fact imagine the existence of a personality structure characterized by strong self-centeredness and confidence in one's ability that favors the most enterprising and confident people to face uncertain and less defined life paths, such as those that distinguish the migratory experience in general. In this sense, New York becomes the paradigmatic case of all America, where a multitude of people and confluence of culture and their ethnic groups not always easily coexist within a common history of uprooting and rebirth that unites them all. Thank you.
And thank you. Yep. Can you hear me? Can you hear us?
I can hear you. I cannot see you, but I can hear you.
That's okay. That's all right. So let me first of all thank all three of you. I think Amy was 18 minutes, Stephen was basically 20. I could have let him go for another maybe 10 seconds. He would have been good. And Rosemary, you were 19 minutes. So we're all good. Let's first have some questions or comments for Rosemary. And Rosemary, there's actually a comment. There's a comment from Paula Costanzo who says she works at Queens College and she'd like to hear from you. So we can set that up one way or another. Paula, you can write to us and we'll forward your email to Rosemary. Peter Barbella, our faithful viewer, asks, do Italians from the Mezzogiorno choose New York in far larger numbers than Italians from the North?
Actually, I didn't go through this differentiation in the data, in the analysis of the data, but I can do it and I will let you know. So I didn't have this. Mm-hmm. I have the old data, and I can do a specific analysis and differentiate the Italian that comes from north or the south of the Italian Sea, which is the difference in the choice of New York. I will give you the answer in a very short future, Peter.
Okay. No, that would be interesting too, because you know historically, I saw figures. Where I think it was like either 1910 or 1915, the percentage of Italians who had come to the United States was basically something like 45% from the north, 45% from the south, and 5% from central Italy. So that was sort of, you know, an interesting figure way back then. That's in 19, I think 10 or 15 when I saw that. And of course, we do know there's historically, right, there's a large Friulian migration to the United States, correct? Am I correct in saying that?
Yeah, but in this case, I get right the question is, it wants to know in this research that is a large number of people that were interviewed through the questionnaire, 4,000 people, which was the prevalence of Italian from the north and the south that make the selection of New York? That's what this is the question, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, and Stephen just messaged to say that there are, I guess, a lot of Trentini in Wyckoff Heights, the community he just spoke of. But let me just mention also for people who aren't aware that a lot of you interviewed thousands of people, which is just incredible. And a good deal of this research is already available in print, both in Italian and in English. And you have a book that came out not too long ago, right, from SUNY Press. Yeah. So a lot of your research from these 4,000 plus interviews is already available, some of it's already available in these books. You want to give the title of them?
Yeah, sure. Sense of Origins. And it's a study of New York Italians, American, and is in SUNY Press. Unfortunately, I cannot show you the cover of the book in this moment because I don't have the chance. The technology doesn't help me today, but if you are interested, you can email me and I will give you more details about how you can get the book and see, you know.
Yeah, they can email any of us because we have access to that information as well. So let me suggest that we have, I'm looking, we have some time left. I don't know if the panelists have questions of each other or if we want to entertain a few more questions from the public. Colleghi, do you have any questions of each other? Or, I mean, it seems to, well, go ahead, Amy, go ahead.
I do, thank you. That's a nice opportunity to offer. Stephen, I'm really interested in your project. And one thing that you said I thought was really lovely and a nice way to think about relationships between neighborhoods. And you said that, you know, Ridgewood and Bushwick were kind of in constant dialogue with each other. So I'm wondering if you can maybe tell us a little bit more about that in that specific context in terms of those two neighborhoods, but also, you know, what does that make you think about, you know, neighborhoods in proximity in general in New York City?
The first question I definitely feel equipped to answer. I also like that language, very American studies dialogue. So essentially, as soon as Ridgewood was developed, it was already, I guess you can say, attracting German immigrants to go live in the nicer housing, the nicer tenements, right? And this, you see a shift coming over between 1915 and 1950, where Ridgewood is a German neighborhood. It is known as Germantown, right? That's how German it is. And even after World War II, there's another migration of Germans from Slovenia. If anyone knows anything about the Yugoslav project and how the minorities in Yugoslavia were forced to Slavinize, there's Germans in Slovenia that go to Ridgewood in the 1940s and 1950s. And that gives you a take of how you know, heavily German this neighborhood was. And its origins are people coming in from Bushwick. Enter the 1960s, what you start to see happening is those Germans living in Ridgewood now have multi-generational wealth. The kids can go to college, GI Bill, right? And remember, I kept saying a lot, that was said twice, that these kind of neighborhoods are reacting to systemic things out in America, you know, the American systems, whether it be capitalism, neoliberalism, et cetera, right? So you start seeing Germans leave Ridgewood for places like Glendale, that which they already had a community, Middle Village, and more importantly, Long Island, right? And what ends up happening is just like Franklin Square. Many of the Germans from Ridgewood slash Bushwick went to Franklin Square. And then what ends up happening is the Italians then move up to Ridgewood, let's say in the 1960s and 1970s, where in 1990, Ridgewood is the largest foreign-born Italian neighborhood in Queens. And then so we see this kind of shifting of the population, right? First Germans leave Bushwick, they go to Ridgewood. Then Italians leave Bushwick to go to Ridgewood. And then now today, we see Mexicans and Ecuadorians and Puerto Ricans and Dominicans, those four large groups of different Latino people, leaving Bushwick for Ridgewood. So in 2000, Bushwick was the largest Latino community in all of Brooklyn, right? All of Brooklyn had the highest concentration of self-identifying Latino people. Now today, Ridgewood is a Latino majority neighborhood. So continuing today, we see people leaving Bushwick and going into Ridgewood. And then my last slide, I'm going to talk about it. There's a couple. There's the M line, which is elevated subway line. There's Flushing Avenue. And then there's Myrtle Avenue, right? And those go right through both of the neighborhoods, through the one, you know, on the peripheries, and then the M line right through the heart. And something I'd be interested in exploring is the kind of social navigation of ethnics, right? From German to Italian to now Latino, from Bushwick to Ridgewood, and then later on Middle Village. So now if you went to Middle Village in the 1980s, German. You go to Middle Village 2010, Italian. And many of them have their ancestries or their history from Bushwick, and how, you know, moving up along literally social, moving through space and also moving through class from Ridgewood to Bushwick, then later northern parts of Queens like Middle Village and Maspeth, and then also Long Island. A lot of these people went to Long Island, almost following each other. It's crazy to think about. The other question about New York City's neighborhoods in general, I don't know enough. I only know about this area really well.
I think you're getting at a trend, a pathway through neighborhoods that I at least recognize still today. You know, it's almost like neighborhoods bump up against each other and they serve as aspirations almost east, right? At least historically. And that's kind of reversed as people come back into the city. So it's been interesting, but I think that was a really lovely response. Thank you.
Yeah, you know, we have a couple of comments, questions. Okay, the first is, appreciating the discussion from CD, grazie. That's our friend Marianne Ray, who used to live up here and now moved down to DC. And then there's Vincenzo, who are the new resident? Who are the new residents going into Ridgewood? Asians, Polish, etc. Yeah.
There's still a heavy concentration of Italians in the northern section, but it's similar to the southern section of Ridgewood numbers in the 90s. So around Fresh Pond Road, you'll have like 20%. This is 2010 census numbers. But the predominantly are those four big Latino groups, which is Mexicans, Ecuadorians, Puerto Ricans, Dominicans. Polish recently started coming after the changing of the density laws in Greenpoint. What that leads to is a gentrification of Greenpoint, where Polish immigrants who came post-fall of the Soviet Union first go to Greenpoint in the 1980s and 1990s. They're outpriced, and there is a significant Polish-American community in Ridgewood now. There's also a Christian Egyptian community. They have two parishes, very vibrant and present. A Nepali community, which also has several kind of Nepali social clubs and restaurants. It's very mixed, but those are, you know, it's not just those, there's also Chinese, Romanians who came really in the 1970s, leaving Hungary, Transylvania, and then also the Serbian Banat. So it's a really mixed neighborhood. It's not like 1940, where you can say like Bushwick is predominantly Sicilian. But there are new immigrant groups coming over, and they're not from one particular place. They're from literally all over the world. We have people from Nepal, people from Eastern Europe, people from South America, people from the Caribbean and Central America. So it's a very mixed demographic-wise.
Okay, great. Any other questions amongst our panelists? Any other? Oh, wow. Okay, hold on. You see it, Steve? There's
something
long there to you.
You want to read it or should?
I'll read it. When and how did Bushwick Italians recognize that Wyckoff Heights portion of the larger neighborhood? Was it considered the transitional zone of mobility? Growing up in the 50s and 60s in far away South Brooklyn, I don't remember Wyckoff Heights, but do remember how strong the border seemed between our Bushwick and a German stronghold. Yes, the stronghold that was always defined as conservative, resistant, and not a little hostile.
So as we saw in the 50s, there's a recognition of that area of Wyckoff Heights via the post office moving and calling itself the Wyckoff Heights Station. As I noted, I could not find in the 1944 tax records Italian businesses north of Cypress, which is literally the Bushwick Ridgewood borderline. But in terms of Italian Americans latching onto and recognizing this area as Wyckoff Heights, it's when the zip codes change. Right. And it's when you have this swath of Italian Americans in the, you know, maybe 5,000 or 6,000 on the Bushwick border. And they want to distinguish themselves from Southern Bushwick, which is on fire, right, which is associated with the blackout, which is as an issue with drugs, right? It's very much the blight of, you know, post neoliberal American cities. Bushwick has it all. So we start seeing the Italian American homeowners, and not all of them are Italian American, but there's still some Germans there, there's a lot of Irish there still. But we start seeing the homeowners in the, what's that would be, the north western section of Bushwick, which is Wyckoff Heights, with single family housing, begin to try to distinguish themselves from the rest of Bushwick. I don't see any examples of it being successful, but it's definitely a kind of cultural moment that we should talk about and what it means for race, ethnicity, and class in 1970s, 1980s, and going into the 90s. Mm-hmm. People think the 90s, everything's over. We're still very much tackling with the 70s and 1990s New York. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I hope that answers the question, Bob.
Good. Okay. Well, listen, we're almost at the end of our time. An hour and a half. I think it's like 3:28 or 3:29. So if we have no more questions and comments, let me begin by thanking Amy, Stephen, and Rosemary for not only good talks, but also for keeping within the time zone. It's really important that we do that. These eventually, for those of you who are listening, these eventually will be up online. We just have to, we clean them up a little bit, put tack on a clap, or you'll probably see the Italian Borderlands you're looking at now. And then we also give some credits to the people involved in the conference. So you'll see that'll take us a little bit of time. We have one a day, remember, for the next until the 21st. So I want to thank you. Tomorrow, same time. Again, between now and the 21st, same time, 2 p.m. Tomorrow we have Literature Beyond Borders with a paper on José Di Manelli, a paper on border crossings and kinship in women's literature, in women's letteratura della migrazione. And we have also Albania's perennial Italian borderland in the novels of Albanian Italophone authors. So with that, hold on, let me just see before we leave. I see two other things. They're just thank yous. Thank you, guys. So with that, I say arrivederci, a domani. Rosemary, best of luck in Italy with the lockdown. We hope that you guys open up sooner than later and so we can all go back and forth. You're quite welcome. I want to wish everyone a buon proseguimento, and I'll see some of you tomorrow and some of you later on.